plaintiff appellant Gary Willis. There are several issues that I'd like to address, and I'd also like to reserve about 5 minutes of my time to respond to the things.
Watch the clock.
Yes, I will. And I'd first like to begin with the following, and that is that the qualified immunity instructions given by the district court at the trial, and with respect to qualified immunity, by inserting the words good faith into a qualified immunity jury instruction, and that's in volume one of the excerpts of record four, the district court introduced a subjective element, which is
an accurate quotation of the law as the Supreme Court phrased it. Is there some case that says you can't put it in an instruction?
Well, it's under Harlow versus Fitzgerald and Anderson versus Creighton.
Weren't they quoting Harlow?
No, I don't think so. No, they were not.
And they were quoting Espinoza, our Ninth Circuit precedent that was there at the time, correct?
Yes.
It's a direct quote from Espinoza.
But such a quote does not should not be included in a jury instruction. Once you put the words good faith in a jury instruction, you're starting to get a subjective versus objective reasonableness of another officer, or how does the officer's behavior compare to what an objectively reasonable officer would have done in light of the clearly established law. The minute you put good faith in there, it becomes subjective, I would say. And the test is that how did the officer's behavior or conduct compare to what an objectively reasonable officer would have done in light of the clearly established law? That's the test. And the judge, putting the words good faith into the jury instructions, said the jury determined the officer's subjective beliefs. This was seriously legally erroneous and harmful error. And the jury...
Why wouldn't it be harmless in this case? I mean, in this case, the parole list is updated every 2 weeks. It's never been wrong before. The cop looks at the parole list. Guy's on parole according to the parole list. And there was no evidence that there was a history of bad parole lists or that the parole lists were not frequently updated. All the evidence was that it seemed like a reasonable thing to rely on. It was just wrong, some clerical error.
Well, it's a very serious clerical error
It's a serious clerical error because it means searches that shouldn't be done without a warrant or exigency or something like that. But nevertheless, it appears to be an innocent and negligent error at most rather than a willful error or an error where any cop would know there's likely to be an error.
I humbly disagree with the court.
Okay, go ahead.
And the reason that I disagree with the court, or
go ahead and explain it.
Yes.
I want to get corrected now.
It's that, first of all, these parole rosters were just typed up by a clerk in the office of Defendant Mora. And anytime something is typed up, this is back in 1996, it wasn't just a computer. I think things are all computerized now, but they weren't back then. Just because it had never happened before, that is not a good enough reason to not look at a couple of facts. Number one,
it could be a mistake. I mean, back then my bank statement occasionally had an error, and a credit card statement might occasionally have an error. The systems weren't as good, and it appears that there was an error, and it was negligent.
Well, I don't think it's negligence. I think it's much more than negligence because it was outdated the minute that parole roster was issued. It was out of date because anybody who's listed on that parole roster could have gotten off.
That didn't happen here because the roster was updated every 2 weeks, and this guy has been off parole for months.
Well, it was March 11th to March 27th, 1996, which is when this was. And I think...
When he was off parole for months before the roster was...
He had been many months. He had been off parole for almost a year.
No, this is not a case where you're off parole. The roster is issued. The roster is issued every 2 weeks, and you went off parole 1 week after the roster was issued.
No, it's quite peculiar. His name was even on there because he's never a parolee.
That means his staleness of the roster is totally irrelevant to this case.
I don't think it is if you look at a document and it's not of date, you put on notice that maybe something might go wrong.
It's out of date at most 2 weeks, and the 2 weeks didn't matter because it had been wrong for months.
Well, I actually like to move on with respect to this because there are other matters. This instruction was actually given with another instruction, which is at volume 1 of 5, to which plaintiff also objected, and it was an incorrect statement of the law as Mullins and Moore, because they had a duty to do more under Motley, and that was actually set forth in the interlocutory appeal of Willis v. Moore. That's in the appendix. And because there had to be probable cause for the search, not reasonable suspicion, as defendant Moore contends in her answer brief at 33, citing an older stop case for the proposition that nothing further needed to be done. It needed to be probable cause. It wasn't probable cause. And the two jury instructions lowered the defendant's burden of proof with respect to qualified immunity. They had to prove that, judged against a reasonably objective police officer, their conduct was reasonable. Instead, the instructions allowed the jury to conclude that defendants could subjectively rely on the parole roster. But under Motley, they had to do more.
What about the language? Is the sentence right after the language you were just objecting to, where it says good faith? The judge told the jury that the officer relying on the information, right, must make reasonable inquiries if warranted under the circumstances. Why isn't that enough to tell the jury that you can't just rely on information and communicate it to you, and then you're sort of off the hook? The judge seemed to say to the jury, if warranted under the circumstances, an officer to be acting, you know, in an objectively reasonable good faith way has to make further inquiries.
The real problem, again, is the good faith part of it, and the second part is that it comes directly before an instruction which essentially says if the parole roster looks all right, you can rely on it.
But that's what I'm saying. The sentence I just read to you directly contradicts that. And why isn't that enough for the jury to have been informed that you can't just take the parole roster as the gold standard? If warranted under the circumstances, an officer might well have to make further inquiries.
The two instructions actually, in a sense, contradict one another, because one's saying one thing and the other's saying, no, you can just rely on the parole roster, and either way, you have some problems. But I really would like to move on to my next, because I have a few to go through. And the next one is the exclusionary rule. And this circuit has used the exclusionary rule in other than cases when police conduct constituted egregious violations.
Did the Supreme Court say something about how we can't use it in 1983 cases?
There are, my understanding is that in the Ninth Circuit, there was an INS case, Lopez Rodriguez versus McKaysey, in which there was egregious conduct, the matter that everything was suppressed in that particular case. Here, I believe there was egregious conduct. First, with respect to the manner in which the defendants dealt with the parole roster. Secondly, with respect to the way in which defendant Mullins falsified his police report. And I think that was quite astonishing, but he did do it. It's ER volume 202 and 205, in which the prosecutor relied, because he stated in it the plaintiff didn't tell him, Mullins, that he was not on parole until they were out in the hallway, as opposed to when the defendants first came into his motel room, and he told them all immediately that he was not on parole and showed them his parole discharge card. And the report said something quite different. It made it falsely appear that the defendants and Sylvius were legally conducting a parole search of the room, that they had obtained Catherine Moy's consent to search the briefcase before they knew plaintiff was not on parole. A prosecutor reading the report alone, which is what happened here, would have viewed Moy's consent to open the briefcase as part of a legal parole search, and then that's totally contradicted by the defendant Warner declaration, where she says that when they first came into the motel room, that Mr. Willis immediately told them he was an armed parole, and showed them a discharge card from the CDCR, and that she left. So you have a situation where you've got people actually being told that he was of the prosecutor being having a report that's just completely false, that caused him essentially to believe that there was no violation of it. And then,
do you want to save the rest of your time?
I think I will. Yes, I will reserve the rest of my time. Thank you.
Good morning, Your Honor. Jose Sullivan, Zepeda, Attorney General's Office for Defendant Mora. At the agreement of counsel, I will be presenting argument for all defendants. The issue in this case is whether an individual who was convicted of a criminal offense and whose conviction was vacated based on the exclusionary rule should be able to obtain damages for that particular violation. At heart, this case comes down, the question in this case is really whether the exclusionary rule, which comes from the civil, from the criminal context, should be applied in the civil context. Like Judge Kleinfeld pointed out, the Supreme Court has never applied it in the civil rights context and has indicated, quite to the contrary, that it should not be so applied. The Supreme Court has actually addressed this issue in the context of immigration cases. Lopez Mendoza said it should not be applied in the immigration context. In that case, it said it should not be applied in the grand jury context in the Calandra case. And as we pointed out in our answering brief, there is a line of authority out of circuit, as well as district courts within the circuit, that explain why it's inappropriate to apply the exclusionary rule in a civil context.
Why is that issue critical to resolving this
appeal? It's not critical to resolve this appeal, Your Honor. The primary claim at issue went to the jury, the qualified immunity issue. The exclusionary rule only goes to a secondary claim, which is for a separate search. So if the court would prefer, I can go ahead and address the jury instruction issue first.
No, I guess if you could skip ahead to the issue involving the search of the briefcase. That's the claim that got disposed of on summary judgment, right?
That's correct, Your Honor. As the district court determined that the briefcase search was proper because the defendants, Officer Mullins, Sylvia's, and the sheriff had the consent of Ms. Moy.
So she says, sure, you can search the briefcase. She said expressly, she said, I have my things in the briefcase. You can search it. Mr. Willis has already said you can't search the room. They ask him for the combination. He won't provide it. And Mr. Sylvia says, oh, we don't need his consent. I'll open it with a knife. I mean, that seemed very difficult in line with the cases that we have, which say that where there is a person present who has a superior access to the area who doesn't consent, that you don't then have valid consent. So I was having some problems with that scenario, since apparently Ms. Moy didn't have the combination of the briefcase, so they open it with a knife. How does that, as a matter of law, which is what the district court found, right, the valid consent as a matter of law?
Well, the two different questions that the district court found. The district court found that the law enforcement officials reasonably thought that Ms. Moy had some sort of consent, some sort of authority to give consent for the search of the briefcase. What they knew at the time was they showed up and Ms. Moy said, she had admitted that she was under the influence and said, I put pipe in the briefcase. So they knew that she was able to put stuff in the briefcase. They also had her admission that she had put, that there was some other drug paraphernalia in there, and then she gave consent for that. Under the circumstances, under the case law, that was enough for law enforcement officials to reasonably believe that she had authority.
Can I ask this?
Yes.
There's no dispute that the officers knew that that briefcase belonged to the plaintiff, not to Ms. Moyer, right?
I don't think it's really clear from the record, Your Honor. Looking through,
he had the combination and she didn't, so that would suggest that it's his briefcase, right? I mean, at least a reasonable jury could conclude that.
there's definitely enough evidence for the jury.
Okay, so let me just read this. Our holding in Impink, which I think was the governing case, but maybe you're going to tell me not otherwise, but Impink said this, where a suspect is present, and Willis was, and objecting to a search, which again, Willis was of the briefcase, implied consent by a third party with an inferior privacy interest is ineffective. That's the governing legal principle that controlled at the time this event, that these events occurred. It seems to me a reasonable officer should have known, given the facts, or at least a reasonable jury could find that a reasonable officer should have known that that consent was not valid under Impink. Why is that?
Well, two things. I don't think I necessarily agree with that proposition that Mr. Willis was actively objecting to the briefcase being opened. What the colloquy that the district court cited in its summary adjudication ruling from Mr. Willis's deposition is he was confronted with the fact that Ms. Moy had admitted to being high and that she had placed something in the briefcase, and they asked him, what do you think about that? He says, I have nothing to do with that, or something to that effect. And then they went ahead and said, we have consent from her. Mr. Willis at that point did not say, no, that's my briefcase, you cannot open, or something to that effect.
Well, he denied them the combination. I mean, they asked him for the combination, he wouldn't provide it. And they said, we don't need his consent, they opened it with a knife.
I think that gets to the point of whether, like Judge Watford was saying, whether this falls within the Impink. There wasn't the type of refusal that there has been in other cases.
Was there any testimony one way or the other about how she got the briefcase open to put her meth pipe into it?
No, Your Honor, the record's not clear on that. The record is not clear on that. There's no testimony that I could find on that particular point.
Oh, nobody asked her. I couldn't find anything.
I couldn't.
If there's a combination lock, either he left the briefcase open and then she locked it, or she has the combination too, because otherwise how could she stick her meth pipe in there? And I couldn't find an answer.
And I think that under the circumstances, law enforcement officials could have derived or could have inferred that she had authority because she was able to do that. But in any event,
I think if it wasn't a locked briefcase at all, then I'd have no trouble with your argument. I certainly would be shocked and offended if anyone opened my briefcase to take anything out or put anything in unless I specifically asked them to. Most people's briefcases are private, but if it was shared luggage, say we're going on a trip, my wife sticks something in without me knowing it, or I stick something in without her knowing it, and it's a shared case, that would be non-private. Neither of us, I imagine, could consent to somebody else looking at it. And I just couldn't find any testimony about how she got the meth pipe in the briefcase if it was locked. If I assume it was locked and only he had the combination, I couldn't figure out how she did it.
Right, and the record's not clear on that point.
You know, on summary judgment, we take all the evidence in the light most favorable to the non-moving party, right?
Yes.
Taking all the evidence in the light most favorable to the non-moving party, couldn't a reasonable jury have found that he had superior privacy interests in the briefcase? He denied the police the combination that they were asking for.
I think
they violated his Fourth Amendment right to reasonable search and seizure.
I think under Impink and the Supreme Court's decision a couple of terms ago in Fernandez, that there was enough for police officers to reasonably believe that Ms. Moy had consent or was able to consent, had enough authority to consent.
The person was gone. I mean, he was out of the scene. And the other person was living there, so she gave consent. So that doesn't seem to be on all fours with this one, or even particularly close.
I agree, Your Honor, and neither is Impink, because in that situation you're talking about a landlord who wasn't really there and didn't have the same type of authority that Ms. Moya appeared to have. Like Judge Kleinfeld pointed out, she knew enough about the briefcase to be able to put something in there. So an inference could be drawn that she had the combination. But I... I'm not going to try to argue that the third, that the Fourth Amendment issue as to the briefcase is straightforward. So it's definitely a close call, but I submit to the court that the district, even if this court disagrees on the district court's determination on the Fourth Amendment issue, as the district court pointed out, the law on third-party consent was not clear enough. Where
differentiate that statement from him, Pink, it seems very clear to me what our circuit's law was. Forget about the Supreme Court, but we don't need Supreme Court authority in the qualified immunity context. Our circuit's law seemed very clear in Impink, and I did not follow at all the district court's attempt to make it sound like it was all convoluted, because it wasn't. I just read you the holding on the case.
Well, Your Honor, the district court went through its analysis and talked about the factors in Pink that were different in that particular situation.
What's unclear about the language that I just read to you, which is the holding of the case, that's what matters. That's the controlling legal principle that these officers should have known governed their conduct. What's unclear about that?
Your Honor, what's unclear exactly how it would apply in this particular case, because one of the things that obviously is really important to understand is exactly what Mr. Willis was doing at the time, because a lot of the case law really comes down to whether there's an actively an individual actively refusing consent and saying you cannot go ahead and open that particular thing, like the case law has in other types of situations. That's not what we have here. What we have here is Ms. Moy consented. The law enforcement officials knew that she had somehow put something into the briefcase.
Did she consent? I didn't see in the transcript that she specifically consented to the search of the briefcase. They just inferred that from the search of the room. Am I correct on that?
No, Your Honor. It's evidence that Officer Sylvia says that she consented to the search of the briefcase.
Do you know? Do you have a cite for that?
I could get that for you. I believe it's either in Mullins' declaration or Sylvia's declaration. And Mullins' declaration appears on page 164 of the excerpts of record. Let me go ahead and try to find it. Actually, it's a little bit unclear, but on excerpts one night, excerpts of record 193, 194, that's the deposition of Mr. Willis, I believe. There's a colloquy about what Officer Willis.
Your very specific statement, don't you have a tab on it there?
Not that particular point, Your Honor, sir.
Moy had admitted to being under the influence and that you put things in the briefcase. And Officer Mullins looked at me and he said, you got anything to say about that? And I said, yes, you did. I don't know nothing about it. And what happened next? They asked me what the combination was. Did you give it to the thug? And what happened next? Officer Sylvia picked up my knife and broke the latch on the briefcase and said, we don't need his permission. So that was all I saw. I didn't see. I saw that Ms. Moy had allowed them to search the room, but not that she had given express consent to the search of the briefcase.
For some reason, did I get it from the California case that the woman said the cops could look at the briefcase?
I think that might have been the California Supreme Court decision.
Perhaps they were inferring it, since there doesn't seem to be anything in the evidence.
Your Honor, and I apologize, I don't have, I'm pretty sure it's hard from the record, and I could try to submit a supplemental letter brief if that'll help on that particular point.
But your issue here is you're saying, let's assume that Ms. Moy expressly consented to the search of the briefcase. You're saying that the reason the officers were at least entitled to be unsure about whether that was valid consent or not is because you don't think Willis was actively objecting in a way that would be required to bring himself within the Impink rule.
I
I think it's the whole context. It's not just that particular part of it, but I think that's a very key part of it because, as you point out, that's one of the key factors that the court looks at under MPEG.
You don't need that if you're correct about what the record establishes, do you? I mean, if two people have joint access to the briefcase and one says you can look at it and the other one says you can't, I think the Supreme Court has said that the consent of one of the two who has access to it is good enough for the cops to look at it.
No, that's exactly what MPEG says is not the case, and that's the case that controls at the time this happened. That's why it matters. I mean, all MPEG says is that the person needs to be objecting. It doesn't say actively objecting. It doesn't say objecting using magic words. But you're just saying that when Mr. Willis refused to provide the accommodation, that didn't constitute an objection to the search of the briefcase. That seems to be your bottom line position.
That's correct, Your Honor. I think that in context, that given the fact that all the officers...
I think Fernandez, the United States Supreme Court case subsequent to MPEG, is the one that I was referring to. MPEG came down in 1984 and Fernandez in 2014. And I was talking about Fernandez. Did the search here occur before Fernandez came down?
It did, Your Honor, because Fernandez took place, was decided a couple of years ago, and the search in this case took place in 1994.
Of course, in Fernandez, the objector was off the site. He was out. They had whisked him off to prison.
That is correct, Your Honor. I see it, that I'm out of time. If I could just go ahead and finish the point. But I think Fernandez is key because it shows that even if someone who could object was taken out, and the Supreme Court addressed this particular point, even if the police took him away in order to avoid him having his refusal to consent, that does not vitiate whether the individual could consent.
So if in Fernandez, if the girlfriend had consented but she didn't have a key, the door, the police could have just used a battering ram to knock down the door and then search the house.
And no, Your Honor, that would not be.
That would happen here?
That would not be our argument. That makes it a little bit more of a difficult case, but under the circumstances, as they submit that law enforcement officials had enough to believe that she recently had consent to for the briefcase search.
Thank you,
Your Honor.
We have your argument. We have some time for rebuttal.
Actually, I don't think I need to rebut very much because it's all been discussed, but I would say that it was an illegal search at the time. The Sylvias and Hood stayed in the room and detained Moy, and because they hadn't, the parole search, Mr. Willis had already told them he wasn't on parole. Miss Mora had gone to...
I don't understand how your point on that gets around the recent Supreme Court decision in Herring, which holds that the exclusionary rule does not apply to negligent police errors. That one was an error in issuing a warrant, as I recall, and this is an error in the parole list. But I can't see how to distinguish them on that basis.
Well,
precisely that, negligent errors.
Well, I don't see there's really anything negligent about the fact that once they got into the hotel room and Mr. Willis told them he was not on parole, that at that point everything should have stopped until they verified he was on parole.
Why?
Why? Because...
Just because a suspect doesn't, or a suspect says something, that doesn't make it presumptively true to the police.
Absolutely not. But on the other hand, if Miss Moore was going to check and see whether or not he was on parole, and that's what she did, she pulled California Sacramento ID warrants, then in the meantime, nothing should have been done. That's my position, at least, because...
The current case says we conclude that when police mistakes, which is what this was, are the result of negligence such as that described here, rather than systemic error or reckless disregard of constitutional requirements, any marginal deterrence does not pay its way. In such a case, the criminal should not go free because the principal has blundered. And what they said, if the police had been shown to be reckless in maintaining a warrant system or knowingly to have made false entries in order to lay the
was negligent.
I'm not
negligent in the least. It was.
I'm quoting to you the position the Supreme Court took.
I'm saying in this case, what happened when the defendants decided to go out and search Mr. Willis' room was not negligent. It was intentional. Intentionally, they wanted to conduct this search, and they were going to do it, and they couldn't get a warrant. And, you know, Mr. Mullins lies in his police report, so he has no credibility. And, you know, he said also at some point in the criminal trial that they'd seen that he'd gotten the tip from the informant said there were
times. You don't need a warrant to search a parolee, and they thought he was on parole because of the error in the last hearing. The warrant had been withdrawn, but because of a clerical error, the police were not told that the warrant was withdrawn. So in both cases, the searches shouldn't have been made if everybody had been careful.
Well, Your Honor, the last thing I'd like to address is the following, and that has to do with how prejudicial it is to have the child molestation charge convictions introduced in evidence at the trial, and should it go back to the...
Wait, they weren't introduced?
They weren't, but they were at the point where Mr. Willis had testified.
But the judge said, I'm keeping it out.
I'm saying that should this case go back to trial, and we have that same ruling, it just shouldn't be. Because it's too prejudicial to have.
But all the judge said was, I'm keeping it out. I agree. I mean, I thought the judge said, I agree with you. It is too prejudicial. I'm keeping it out. But if for some reason when your client testifies, I don't know what he might say, but if he does something that opens the door, I'll revisit it. Isn't that all the judge said?
Well, that's not quite as benign as it sounds because, you know, you don't know. Who knows what's going to open the door? And if it's opened, that's the end of it. That's the end of the case. And it's a very old conviction. He should be punished for it in this case because he served his time for that. And he has to register for the rest of his life. But it's a terrible, terrible type of thing to come out in evidence. The jury's just put an even stamp and it puts the plaintiff in a terrible position. And with respect to the other conviction, same thing under Simpson versus Thomas. You know, when you already know this guy's been on parole, been in prison, he's been on parole. And what you've got is additional evidence that he's still a bad man, and that's not good. It's like the Cohen versus Papa case. You know, the jury will form these opinions of him, and they're not going to accord him any credibility.